Okay, hopefully it's going to them.
Check out our Twitter, yeah, Occupy London. That's what I keep don't get from people saying how they don't want the cameras or to be out and blatantly out, saying that they don't want to be on camera. But then I think, okay, so how about the agents? Oh, good. Occupy London has put this tattoo there already.
Barnet has action, Suzanne Bell, Socialist Way. There's the right.
Well, Sam, Ben had some had a banana.
I think it's going to be Occupy, sir. Oh, nice. And Barnet, that's good. Okay, Saint yes. There's actually a lot of demonstrations. It's like Barnet at the moment is the front line to actually save the services in London. Anyway, thank you guys for joining us. If you could, please tweet this out, send this on Facebook. Post this to the event page and to your groups, United Against Tories, all the momentum groups, the pages, all of them. Thank you.
The banking tells you to move along the rows as far as you can, but people are not able to get accuracy. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Okay, I think it's going to be a full house tonight.
Move this way so that people can get in.
No, they can stand. I mean, they should be able to move.
No, I have a pen. I've sacrificed my pen. Phil, come sit here, there are like five seats here. Have you seen this?
Yep, I think you can.
I believe that she is the one who sent my friends.
This room here.
No, I'm over.
That's mine. Sorry.
There's no green card. So what it says is Dr. Matteo de Martino, the BMA.
I can actually just ask them to stand up.
Is effectively gambling with patients' health over Health Secretary General Bucon's plan to change the Chinese project to today's including on the social health. And he said that the changes would be strictly injected. Yeah, and he's still lying.
Otherwise, it's more like a nose.
If Cameron has any sense, he would say the NHS will reshuffle the hunt. But it's a transition of the march, because the real enemies are the
tourists. Good evening. Who would like to take the seat as soon as you can, so that we can start the meeting? Thank you. Contribute to the first public meeting of Momentum Barnet. It's a very historic night for us all. But what is Momentum Barnet? Well, it hasn't yet been specifically defined, and it'll be based on the input of everyone who wishes to give some input to contribute over the next few weeks and months. There'll be meetings for views to be expressed, and the grassroots have taken the initiative here after years of suppression. And it's the people who now have a voice and misuse it, as they have a leader who has pledged to listen to them. But there are two central things that Momentum already believes in: an anti-austerity economic policy and the election of a Labour government at the first opportunity. Tonight, this event will focus on poverty, inequality, housing and hunger, libraries, public services, housing, both nationally and in Barnet, arguably one of the richest boroughs in this country, and yet feeding members of its community from food banks. We have speakers from the Barnet Labour Party talking on the EU referendum, among other things, the Junior Doctors Campaign, Save Barnet Libraries, Unison, and from the Barnet Alliance for Public Services. And we want to hear from as many of you as possible your opinions, your thoughts, your vision of the future. Later we'll hear from the Shadow Chancellor, John Mcdonnell, who's been MP for Hayes and Harlington for almost 20 years. He's staunchly against the current government's austerity programme and instead advocates the creation of a high-wage economy. As does the Nobel Prize-winning Professor Paul Krugman, who refers in the New York Times to what is happening in this country as the austerity delusion. All of the economic research that allegedly supported the austerity push has been discredited, he writes. Widely touted statistical results were, it turned out, based on highly dubious assumptions and procedures, plus a few outright mistakes, and evaporated under closer scrutiny. The case for cuts was a lie. Why does Britain still believe it? At the Labour Party conference last summer, Oxford Professor Danny Dorling spoke. His work concerns issues of housing, health, employment, education, and poverty. He pointed out that on a list of the richest countries in the world that shows the biggest gaps between rich and poor, England is third. Since the Great Recession hit in 2008, he writes, only the 1% has grown richer, while the rest find life increasingly tough. The gap between the haves and the have-nots has turned into a chasm. While the rich have found new ways of protecting their wealth, everyone else has suffered the penalties of austerity. But inequality is more than just economics. Being born outside the 1% has a dramatic impact on a person's potential, reducing life expectancy, limiting education and work prospects, depriving the young of a home and the opportunity to securely bring up a family, and even affecting mental health. Danny Dorley insists that there is no reason why our lives couldn't be very different. Decent housing, secure jobs, a supportive state, if only things were done differently. We want everyone to have decent homes, dignity at work and in retirement, public investment in public services, including high quality health care and education for all. We will never achieve this under the present government, whose vision is entirely different. So let me introduce the speakers here on the panel and let the first public Momentum Barnet event begin. And let us fight together for a fairer, more equal and more democratic society. On my left is Helen Davis, who is the branch chair of Barnet Unison and member of Unison's NEC. On my far left, I've got, now he's given me three pages. Very appropriately. On the far left, Councillor Paul Edwards, who's representing the Labour Party in Barnet. And he says about himself, modestly, he's a Labour councillor in Underhill, the chair of Chipping Barnet Labour Party, a member of the Cooperative Party, a Unite member, a retired Unison member, who's worked for 25 years as a social worker in three London boroughs, 18 years in the London Borough of Barnet. He has been the NALGO and Unison branch secretary in Barnet for 10 years and worked for an international NGO based in Brussels after leaving the London Borough of Barnet. He says Barnet is his home, but he's still a proud Scouser, which you'll soon find out, who grew up on a council estate. He's a lifelong Everton supporter, and thanks his mum and dad for bringing him up a Catholic socialist. And although they worked all their lives, some people today might call them benefits groungers, as they relied on benefits while bringing up their family. It's nearly finished, I promise. They taught him to remember that it was Labour that created the NHS, ensured free education for all, built council houses, and to never forget to show solidarity with those less fortunate than yourselves. And on my right, and this seems sadly short now. And we've got Dr. Matteo De Martino. He's here talking on a very important issue, the junior doctors campaign. He's been a junior doctor for 4 years and has a minimum of five more to go before he's no longer a junior doctor. And he is from and BMA rep for a local hospital. So these are our three speakers. Before we start, we've got a short film to show you. Owen Jones meets Momentum.
Thank you for watching.
A sinister Machiavellian gang of far-left extremists who want to drive anyone out of the Labour Party, somewhere so bright as Vladimir Lenin, who are going to nationalise your mother and all the rest. That's the general media portrayal at the moment. Maybe a bit of exaggeration. But I'm going to find out what is the truth behind Momentum, this group which is heavily involved in the Labour Party ever since Jeremy Corbyn's landslide victory as Labour leader. I want to find out the truth about them. Disclaimer, I do support what Momentum are trying to do. I'm going to find out about them, go behind, you know, the media spin, who are Momentum, what are they up to.
What's this sinister-looking map? Is this an armed insurgency or something?
These show the local Momentum supporters groups.
So how many groups are there?
There's around 100, but it's really actually in close firing going along to local group meetings. People who of all ages, all backgrounds, all professions, coming together, talking about the issues that are in their community. And I think that's how politics should be, really. It should be at a local level.
So, Emma, Momentum, according to some of its critics, it's a sinister Trotskyist faction about to purge all of its opponents. What do you say to that?
Jeremy Corbyn's leadership campaign in the summer mobilised and inspired vast swathes of people. Momentum is the continuation of that energy and that enthusiasm.
So,
yeah, I don't think there's anything that sinister about that, actually.
It doesn't sound sinister, it's additional. If you had a vision for Momentum, your own vision, what do you think it's for?
I think the way our society is structured, it's easy for people to feel disempowered. The only thing that counters that is the hope that something can actually change. And I think Momentum can be a way of bringing people together and giving people a political voice. People have always been the driving force of history. So I think that Momentum is about building that popular power at a grassroots level and really carrying that forward. And ultimately, you know, politicians are representatives of the people.
Without getting a little violent out, I'm sure it gets a lot of online abuse. But there's a narrative at the moment that it's a problem with abuse going from the left. And some of the critics have said, there's Momentum people behind this. What do you say to that?
Internet trolling and abusive behaviour has existed for more than 3.5 months, and Momentum launched on the 8th of October. So I think that those criticisms are ultimately a way of discrediting Momentum, discrediting the left, discrediting Jeremy Corbyn.
Because some of the attacks have been on Momentum Twitter accounts, which aren't actually they're parodies.
Exactly.
There's a few of those. One was called Momentum.
What we're part of here is a, you know, something that's building a mass movement. It's going to bring lots of people along with it. And of course, there are going to be some sort of teething problems and small hiccups along the way. But I think people have to hold on to the bigger picture, which is that actually it is very good for our democracy. It's very healthy for our democracy to bring lots of other people into it. Politics, you know, it's something that needs to reflect the diversity of our society. And if Momentum can play a part in that, then I will ignore the criticism from people that will see a tweet by Momentum and think that somehow Momentum is responsible for all internet trolling. So, you know, that's not to say that I think that trolling or abusive behaviour is in any way acceptable from where, you know, wherever it comes. And I think we absolutely have to take a strong line on and stamp out.
One of the main criticisms of Momentum is, well, why not just join the Labour Party? Why does there need to be something, this Momentum movement to organise people?
I absolutely would encourage people to join the Labour Party. I'm a member of the Labour Party myself. All of the people who are involved in Momentum, who hold positions within Momentum, will be members of the Labour Party. Political parties in general are very old institutions. They're quite bureaucratic. Momentum is a way that, you know, is a stepping stone into that sort of political activity. You know, Labour parties are desperate to recruit young people. They're desperate to sort of, obviously, to become an elected, let's be honest. And I think that relationship can definitely benefit both of them.
momentum's come under attack from MPs like Michael Duggar, who sat in the shadow cabinet recently. What do you think is driving those attacks?
Jeremy Corbyn's leadership took all of us by surprise. I don't think anybody saw that coming, and I think there were people who were, you know, kind of in power before Jeremy's leadership election, and maybe feeling, you know, they're not quite sure what's going on, and feel a bit unearthed by the political earthquake. So I think that comes from there. But ultimately, we're much stronger when we're together and we're united. And I think that that's the sort of message that we need to take forward.
So, yeah, Melissa, how did you get involved?
When I was a teenager, I was a member of the Labour Party and sort of like drifted away, and then Jeremy Corbyn's campaign sort of like re-energised me, and I just want my children to have what I have for granted, and it looks like these things are being whittled away. A public health service, education. I have free university education now. Me and my wife are actually thinking about how we sort of like save together. So I don't want my children to be in debt. It's tough as a sort of, I'm self-employed, run my own business. And it's a really tough environment for self-employed people. And everybody says they're pro-business, but I don't think people understand what pro-business is. And then Jeremy's campaign talks about fair tax system. It resonates, especially with small business, because proportionately as a small business owner, you're paying more taxes than a corporation, and it just gets to you. So like, you work hard, you pay your taxes, and you're competing with a business that doesn't pay any taxes. It's a no-brainer, it's gonna come out on top, and that's the story all throughout.
Momentum's got a lot of stick from MPs from a certain wing of the Labour Party, also the media. Is that tough?
It's strange to see the contrast between the reality of if you go to groups and you see people working together in a positive way, but the way it's presented in the media, often in elements of the media, being this hard leftist Trotskyite infiltrating plan. I think there's a coordinated attempt to undermine Jeremy Corbyn in the media, and I think that momentum is a way sometimes that's been presented to sort of bat him over the head. I think that can be overcome. I think we're seeing that momentum's not going anywhere, it's growing. And I'm really excited over the next four and a half years and beyond what momentum can develop into.
Oh, yeah. Smart and... Hi, how are you? You're Beth.
Yes.
Beth. So Beth, are you a sinister far left extremist hell bent on revolutionary overthrow of the country?
No.
How long have you been involved with Labour for yourself?
I joined when I was 16. I'm now 18, so 2 years. But I've really begun to get involved in London Young Labour and the Labour Party more since Jeremy Corbyn's election.
So what would you like to see Momentum do? What you, in the next few weeks, months, if you have kind of like a big ambition for Momentum, what would you like to see it achieve?
We have a huge issue of lack of political engagement, but lack of power with people. There's a democratic deficit, as I like to say. Momentum organising in local communities can really start to engage people on issues and get them involved, bring politics into their lives on a daily basis.
What would you like to see Momentum do specifically in the coming months?
We've got somebody here actually now who's organising a series of workshops and lectures, and you know, people's PPE. So it's a way of bringing Oxford and Cambridge university course to people free of charge, and bringing lots and lots of people in. I think that's the sort of stuff that I really want to see. People thinking about, what is it in my life, in my community, that I think is really unfair? Who else thinks this is unfair? What can we do about it to make it better? And what political message can we say to the Conservatives who are pursuing this endless, relentless policy of austerity? What message are we actually giving them?
I told you they were scary. Not quite a sinister bunch of extremists they've been portrayed as. You know what? They're just people who are determined to kind of capture the enthusiasm we saw whipped up during Jeremy Corbyn's leadership campaign and put it to some use. There's a lesson there. Don't always believe the way the media spins from. Are you convinced by them? Do you want to get involved? What sort of priorities would you like them to focus on in the coming weeks and months? How does this all fit in with the way Labour's going? So leave your comments, as ever. I will respond to some of them if I can. And subscribe, and I'll see you next time.
So that's really an interesting film, but let us do some talking now. Let's start with the woman on the panel. And if you'd like to speak, I'm going to be really ruthless this time because we've got lots and lots of speakers. we've got more speakers from the floor, so if you would like to start off, thank you.
Well, I'm Helen Davison from I'm branch chair of Barnet Unison. The little joke me and Paul had earlier is that he's on the physical far left of me, but politically I'm regarded as of the far left, and that one of the, what is it, sinister Trotskyist factions, maybe, that might fit the bill. Yeah. I'm in the Socialist Workers' Party. I just think it's important that, you know, we're honest about positions here. But what I'm here to really talk about is the campaign that's been going on in our branch and the campaign in this community. Because whilst it was interesting in Owen Jones's portraying momentum as people who are very reasonable, wanting to engage, talk to the Tories, present an alternative viewpoint. It's not the experience I've had of living, sorry, I don't live here, feels like it, and of working in Barnet for all these years, that the Tories are reasonable people with whom you have a reasonable dialogue, and the light bulb goes on and they go, do you know what, you're right. I'll give you some examples. Our campaign has been fighting the mass outsourcing of all of our services, all of your services. Who lives in Barnet here?
Hey.
Yeah. The services are gone, all right? And we've been campaigning for 8 years to try and keep them in Barnet. And one thing I have learned throughout the campaign is that when it comes to questions of economy, that quote of that economist was brilliant. Highly dubious assumptions which evaporated. Now, for those of us who've been steeped in the campaign on privatisation, when you go to Tory, when you go to the council committee meetings, you read the reports coming through, they're based on assumptions which then evaporate in the reality. And one of those was, which I was very involved with, was the Your Choice Barnet debacle. So we were presented with reports which said that the learning disability services that we have need to be put into a local authority trading company. They can't be run by the council anymore because, well, and a new reason was invented, because you can't do this with direct payments. You can't have this service run in-house anymore. We opposed that. We were quite coherent in our arguments. And what we said was that actually the outsourcing of this service, just as everything else, is about undermining the terms and conditions of the workers who provide those services and deliver those services. And it's about also an inferior service which will be delivered back to you. And a year, 2 years after the outsourcing of that group of services took place, the council came back for cutting services. And the CQC report also was highly critical of that service in terms of the consistency of care that people received, and also the use of the overuse of agency staff. It also meant that our workers got a near 10% pay cut, and that's on backs of wages which are quite poor as it is. But we have been involved in campaigns. That campaign saw 11 days of strike action to try and get those wages reinstated. But over the last 8 years, we have seen strike action, we've had demonstrations, we're part of the Save Barnet Libraries campaign, which is an incredibly vibrant campaign in the community. We've supported the housing campaigns, and to be honest, whilst we haven't stopped any one of the outsourcing projects, we have slowed them down, because I don't think anybody thought it was going to take this length of time. Because usually what happens in localities is a report comes out, it gets rubber stamped, and bang, that workforce goes out. And we have managed to hold back and develop that debate over the years. And we couldn't have done that without the community campaign, the Barnet Alliance for Public Services, which Unison was very much a part of, And I'm proud of that campaign and what it achieved. And I speak on this platform as a supporter of anti-austerity politics. All of us share this agenda. The strength of our campaign in the community has been a preparedness amongst all of us to pool our resources together and to not let the individual party politics get in the way. We look at what are we trying to achieve and what resources do we need to achieve that. So we've used films, bloggers have helped us, local experts have helped us and provided their advice. And I think that last year, last summer, when the Tories won again, that could have been a moment, and I think for a lot of people, after the election result came in, did anyone here feel depressed? Okay, yeah, we did, didn't we? But some of us, 2 days later, were fortunate enough to be on a demonstration here in Barnet. Who was here on that demonstration? Exactly. Did it feel good?
Yes.
Yeah. Because when we got on that demonstration, all of a sudden, and I think I'm not the only one that found it hard to get out of bed that day thinking, oh, God, here we go again. But actually, when we came together, the mood was, damn, they're in again. Damn, what's going on? And we had a discussion about it. Actually, the Tories had lost votes. They got in having lost 0.8% of their vote. How did that happen? So it's not the case that the Tories we have in power are popular. I think the anti-austerity measure and the Jeremy Corbyn's campaign to become leader of the party, of the Labour Party, shows that actually the anti-austerity message is popular. It's not necessarily reflected in Parliament yet, and there are some interesting votes, aren't they? You look at the vote that they had on Syria, 50% of the population thinks that it wasn't a good idea to go to join in on the fight in Syria. Now, whatever individuals think here about that, that's interesting because 60% of the politicians voted in favour. And you look at other votes that take place, it has been in the past routinely the case that polls show the population is not in favour of mass privatisation. And yet, what do we get? Privatisation. We're being disenfranchised. Thank you. We're being disenfranchised over the years, and I don't think this is just about winning an election. I think it's about what underpins that. I think it's about how we mobilise and counter the popular arguments. The avalanche of attacks that are coming for Jeremy Corbyn, it was entirely predictable because what shits up the establishment, what they are absolutely petrified of is movements like Syriza, Podemos. They're petrified that Scotland nearly became an independent country just a year and a half ago. And it's movements like that, losing a grip on the state, that is what Jeremy Corbyn to them reflects. And I think it's important, therefore, that the people, that, I mean, I'm told that there's been a near doubling of the size of the Labour Party in Barnet, which is fantastic, but I want to see a doubling of the size of protests that take place. Because it is not through elections on their own that we get change. Most people are working out what they think about things. Unless we beat it out on the streets, then we're not going to engage with people and make sure that debate is in people's faces. That's where I'm coming from, and that's why I'm very proud and very pleased to be speaker tonight. And I'd like to think it's not just because I'm a woman, but I think other people will be speaking from part of the campaign. What I would like to see momentum develop is that it becomes a forum whereby people of the left, socialists, begin to talk about our politics, about our policies in the broader sense of things. What world are we looking for? What are the solutions? We don't all agree in this room, but I want to hear those debates. When is nationalisation good? What are the pitfalls? All there's a myriad of things we could be talking about, and I do think that it's important that there's a forum, and I would hope that this forum would be it, where people are engaging with those debates. There is about to be a debate on the European Union. Unless the left engages with it in a way in which you can discuss both being in and out of Europe from a left-wing perspective, it will be dominated by a right-wing rhetoric in and out of Europe, and the racists will have their day. So I think that that's the sort of things I want to see in momentum, activity on the streets, and a forum whereby people can come together and discuss. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. And the format that we were thinking of, if that's all right with you, is to have the three speakers speaking up here, and then contributions from the floor, just ask questions to the panel. And then there'll be speakers with much shorter speeches from the floor, and everybody can contribute to that too. So if I call now upon Councillor Paul Edwards, you know all about his life. He's going to talk on three or four different topics.
Thanks to good evening, comrades, sisters and brothers, or friends, whichever you prefer. It's a real privilege for me tonight to come and talk to you at this meeting and speak on behalf of the Labour group. However, I do need to put a little bit of a disclaimer on that, because I'm going to say what I really believe, and it isn't necessarily supported by everybody in the Labour group, although I'm sure most of them do. But I'm just making that disclaimer just in case somebody says you said this and the Labour Party's position is X. So just let's be clear. I looked on the Momentum's website today, and one of the aims of the Momentum is to strengthen the Labour Party by increasing participation and engagement at local, regional and national levels. And furthermore, Momentum is committed to supporting the Labour Party winning elections and entering government. If anyone here tonight is in any doubt that we need a Labour government in this country, let me direct your attention to what's happening with Barnet Tories in the London Borough of Barnet. Tory Barnet today is characterised by a growing inequality of income and wealth. There is evidence of social cleansing taking place, driven by the redevelopment of the borough, the council estates, where developers call the shots and not the political authorities. In my own ward of Underhill, which I represent, is Dollis Valley Estate, and we have seen two-thirds of the tenants who are in unsecure tenancies moved elsewhere. Even some secure tenants who have to pay the bedroom tax are now finding that they won't be able to stay in Dollis Valley because they won't be able to afford the new rents. The price of a new three-bedroom house on Dollis Valley is £725,000. Even the Tory leader agreed with me when I said that this price cannot be called affordable. These properties are now being marketed in Hong Kong, and I've heard claims that Chinese investors are buying to let. Well, that's hardly surprising, because according to Zoopla, you may have heard of that website, buy-to-let returns have soared to a 14-month high in January of this year, with landlords making an average of £22,000 profit on the investment just in last year alone. At the first full council meeting of 2014, after the council elections, when there was an increase in the number of Labour councillors, Barnet Labour moved a motion calling on Barnet Council to regulate private landlords and to protect tenants. Before this debate, the Tories moved a motion to give dispensation to Tory councillors who are private landlords, especially those with properties in Barnet. These would normally have been excluded from the debate because they have a pecuniary interest. So all the Tory councillors, who are also private landlords, changed the rules so that Barnet Council would not be able to regulate their behaviour as a Tory council. The Tories are obsessed with keeping the council tax down and are prepared to make savage cuts in our public services to ensure that people living in £3 million houses, yes, there are £3 million houses in Barnet, so long they don't have to pay their fair share for services to the less well-off and vulnerable members of our community. Let me tell you something about these Tories. They regained control in 2002, and at that time I was a senior council officer in the London Borough of Barnet. And the Tory council was demanding senior officers to come forward with proposals to make cuts between 5 and 10% in our budgets. There was no economic crisis at that time, yet the Tories set out then on their 14-year journey of the major amputation of council-run services. Barnet Tories have always been the party of cuts. Whatever the rhetoric they use to dress it up, they are ideologically opposed to publicly owned controlled council services. At the time of my departure from the council employment, there were more than 4,000 directly employed workers delivering services to the residents in Barnet. What we see now is a diminishing directly employed workforce and a growing privatisation or outsourcing of council services. The Tories wear this model of local government as a badge of honour. But the impact on the delivery of locally accountable services is a growing distance between those who pay for these services, i.e. we as local taxpayers, and those who deliver them. As a local councillor, I'm not allowed to make a phone call directly to a senior council officer about an issue raised by one of my constituents. I have to do instead go send an email to something called Members Enquiries. They give me a reference number, telling me that the appropriate officer will contact me in 5 working days. If elected representatives have such difficulties, what chance do you as ordinary residents have of getting in touch with the appropriate officer, who may well be based in the Midlands, the north of England, or in fact the north of Ireland? Comrades, this is the model that was rolled out by the Tory government. Nicholas Ridley's dream of local councils that only meet twice a year, once to agree the contracts, and secondly, to elect the mayor. This is going to become the reality with this Tory government. It has already started and did so under the last coalition government. Let me give you a concrete example. Free schools. Local authorities have a statutory duty to ensure sufficient school places for their children in the borough. However, the LEA cannot open its own schools. Only academy sponsors, hand-selected by the Department of Education, can open and run new schools. This is what's going to happen in my ward of Underhill. The owner of Barnet Football Club has sold Underhill Stadium to the Education Funding Authority for about £14 million, the old football club, and the Department of Education is going to agree that Arc Academy chain, a private company, can open up a school for 1,900 kids. Despite the constant inquiries from my ward colleague, Councillor Amy Trevelyan, and myself, we have obtained very little information. According to the Barnet Football Supporters site, the Secretary of State for Communities has just paid £14.25 million for this property. We are being told that a planning application will come forward in the summer, which means residents will only be able to object on planning grounds. But even in the unlikely event that the Tory planning officers refuse permission, the Secretary of State can simply impose the will on the local community. None other than Michael Gove, who's now complaining about the European Union being undemocratic, gave himself the power to ignore local opinion and impose free schools against local wishes when he was Secretary of State for Education. What a hypocrite. Yeah. After 3 years of contract with the Capita, the Tories are proposing to evaluate the contract, but they're going to do this in secret. Councillor Jeff Cook moved a motion at the last full council meeting asking for the review to be open and transparent in front of residents. The Tories argued against this, saying Capita would not participate if the debate was in public. So, comrades, millions of pounds of our money are being paid over to a large multinational company to provide services we cannot scrutinise the performance of this company. So there you have it. Tory Barnet is set to become the model for other councils when the Tory government gets the referendum out of the way. The general election is not until 2020, but we have 2 opportunities to show here in London we want Labour values of economic social equality, which embraces diversity of rich ethnic communities. The first opportunity is the London elections on the 5th of May, and we have to deliver a London Assembly with Sadiq as our mayor, and return Andrew Dismar as our constituency candidate. and deliver the party list members. But let me be it would be remiss of me not to say something about the referendum. Please give me just a second to talk about this. Our party leader, Jeremy Corbyn, has made it clear that he wants to see UK as a part of a social Europe. I agree with him. From 2005 to 2010, I worked in Europe, in Brussels, where I paid income tax, health insurance to the Belgian government, as a Belgian worker would do. I also paid the local equivalent of council tax, and I had the right to revote in the local elections. What's wrong with that? The Tory anti-Europeans, like the MP for Chipping Barnet, Secretary of State for Northern Ireland, want you to believe that we'd be better off on our own. They are playing on fear by saying we can control immigration and prevent acts of terrorism by not being in the EU. The North of Ireland benefits economically and socially from being a member of the UK and of the EU. And I normally take the view that Tony Benn took, we should be careful about calling for government ministers to resign. But I am tonight going to make an exception by taking a view to leave the EU. I believe Theresa Gillies is not acting in the interests of all the people of Northern Ireland. She's proposing to build a wall around, is she proposing to build a wall around the six counties and to demand the Republic of Ireland pays for it? Or more seriously, will the police cover the border? Or the British Army? Didn't we try that once? Oh yes, we did.
Oh,
it was in the
desert. Okay,
well, there's a few other things I wanted to say, but can I just finish by saying that clearly in the constitution or the aims of the on the aims of momentum, we need to deliver a Labour government, and we have to do this together, and we have to do it in a frank and open way. And I know this comrade on my right here is not in the same political party as me, but I've got absolutely massive respect for this woman and John Burgess and Patrick at the back for fighting the Tories locally in Barnet and for defending the workers. But my time as a branch secretary was a piece of piss, excuse my friends, compared to what these people have to put up with. So I have absolute nothing but respect for these, and I congratulate them on the hard work that they're doing. Sorry I can't finish the work.
There's one more speaker speaking on something that affects us all, on the junior doctors issue, and this is Dr. Matteo De Martino, and thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for asking me to come and speak to you here today on what may not just be a momentum issue, but frankly is an issue that has cross-party reach and should concern every member of the public throughout all the counties of the UK. But first of all, what is an actual junior doctor, and who are these people who are going on strike, who are campaigning against the government, who are facing these changes? A junior doctor is essentially anybody who has ever treated you in the hospital who isn't a consultant. They might be fresh out of university, or they could be 11 to 15 years out of university. I have colleagues that have taken 10 to 15 years to reach consultancy because they have gone out and done research, they have gone out and cared for loved ones, or they have simply taken time out to go and provide their medical services to those less fortunate across the world. So, with that thought in your mind, next time you hear the phrase junior doctor, bear in mind that no other profession would actually send somebody who, say, would be a solicitor for 10 years as a negotiator on a contract and call them a junior. It is something that has been used by the media and the government to spin to make their life easier. Ladies and gentlemen, we have tried to reclaim that, but we are your junior doctors and we fight for you at the moment. Now on Saturday, the BMA rejected cost neutrality. Cost neutrality is something the government has based its entire contract proposal on so far. And in rejecting it, we crossed a Rubicon. The tide looks as if it is changing and could change in our favour. What we need now is a push from us as junior doctors, from other members of the health service, and the support from you as our general public that we serve. In 2013, the BMA agreed to a principle of cost neutrality. And they based that on a 5-day service They agreed to it for improvements to the Monday to Friday service that we give to you, on the basis that the emergency service we provide on the Saturday and Sunday is there and always will be there. But in order to have that, and it was initially agreed by the Tory government at the time, that that would require a further injection of money. Unfortunately, this changed when the government started to use their political mandate to justify a need for 7-day services. But ladies and gentlemen, I put it to you that a mandate is not a mandate when it is unfunded, when there is not the money to provide those 7-day services, and actually the government themselves do not even know what they mean by those 7-day services. It is important to know at this time that we are there for you in the NHS 24/7, 24 hours, 7 days a week. What the government want, we are not sure, but we base our arguments on the assumption that what they must mean, because we provide emergency services, is elective services. Unfortunately, despite even the DDRB, who are a supposedly independent review body, rejecting the premise of cost neutrality and that 7-day services could be provided on a 5-day budget, the BMA were hoodwinked into accepting the new goalposts set by the Tory government on the basis of their mandate and their solo efforts in government. And in being hoodwinked and accepting this, they were robbed of their strongest argument. The argument that we in the grassroots, those of us that have been in the papers doing media interviews, pulling stunts, that we have been able to argue that, ladies and gentlemen, the government want a 7-day service for the cost of 5-day staffing. And that is something that cannot and will not work without putting your lives at risk. As junior doctors, we are up against the spin of the government, the spin of a government that have been preparing this plan for years. I was on a night shift the day the Tory government got into power, and that was one of the worst night shifts I've had, because I knew on that day that this was coming, and I think all of us knew that these changes were coming. Austerity, cuts to public services, and the start of a privatisation of the NHS. We are facing a government spin. They tell you that we are getting a pay rise. They tell you that we are already paid well, that we don't work Saturdays, we don't work Sundays. Well, ladies and gentlemen, in December, I worked 3 out of the 4 weekends. Now, I don't begrudge that. I knew what I was getting into when I qualified as a doctor, and I chose it willingly and give my life to that. What we say, though, is that we do not have more to give. At the moment, the NHS is stretched. It is underfunded. It is understaffed. There are retention problems in the NHS. We have 37% of people who were interested in studying medicine a year ago are no longer interested. We have had significant drops in people applying to specialty training after their first 2 years out of university. And the specialty I work in has a roughly 20% attrition rate at midway through their training. Ladies and gentlemen, doctors are failing to want to do the profession anymore, because services are stretched, they are overworked, and morale, especially in this current time, thanks to what the government is doing, is at its lowest. They tell you that we have deaths, 11,000 deaths at a weekend. They are spreading a false fear of death. They are causing actual cases of harm now to patients. I have seen 2 ladies come into maternity day units who have not felt their baby move all weekend, but did not come in because they were scared and they were worried they would come to more harm at the weekend. We have had doctors on question time talking about their liver transplant patients who are worried about being given a liver that they may have been waited years to receive because of what Hunt and the government are saying. And this is the spin that we must counteract. They have given a fallacy of base pay rises, but with one hand, but the removal of our premium for working Saturdays and overnight with the other, resulting in actually a net pay cut of up to 30 to 40%. This is for people who may be in their 30s, have been junior doctors for 10, 11, 15 years, who have children, mortgages. It is not a matter of asking for a pay rise. Ladies and gentlemen, we are fighting to keep our pay as it is and to not be overstretched further. Because at the end of the day, tired doctors make mistakes. We do not want to, but it is fact, as we are only human. The reality, and one that the government will not face up to and will not admit to you, the general British public, is that we just need more doctors. This is about getting 7 days of service with 5 days cost. It's not that we don't want to work the Saturdays. We go in, we give up our time with our loved ones, our family, we miss birthdays, weddings and so forth. But we go in and we do it because that is the job we chose and we love. But ladies and gentlemen, if this contract and the government's plans go through, yes, you may get a 7 day service. But what they are doing is spreading us thinner. They are overstretching us and they are overworking us. And what that means is that if we do accept that there are more deaths at a weekend, which we don't, but just imagine that we do, all they are doing is spreading that risk no longer at a weekend, but throughout the week. That risk will now be averaged from Saturday to Friday instead of at weekends, but it does not exist anyway. This isn't about pay, it's about safety. But let me tell you a little bit about our pay, because that is a myth that is portrayed throughout the media, whether it's BBC, The Telegraph, The Mail, whoever. Junior doctors leave university with an average of £60,000 worth of debts when I qualified. Under current tuition fees, it comes closer to £100,000. The starting salary for a junior doctor is roughly £21,000 a year. And over the course of our training, we will have to sit exams that we pay for ourselves at about £400 each per exam. Most of them, only about 40% of people will pass. We also have to go to conferences, we have to go to training days, and all of these things are required in order to continue with our job, and they are not contributed to. Ladies and gentlemen, even the figures that are true, that are quoted in newspapers, bear in mind they do not tell you the deductions we have to make in order to continue serving you. The NHS is exhausted. It is struggling. Whether you're a junior doctor, whether you're a consultant, whether you're a nurse, whether you're a midwife, we are stretched beyond our numbers and our abilities. You just have to look at recent press from this weekend, the Daily Mail and the Mirror reporting about a local hospital not too far from here, North Middlesex. They saw 450 patients in one Friday night. They had a 7 hour waiting time, and I have worked with that A&E. It isn't because they're slow, it is because they are underfunded and undermanned. I have heard A&Es described as war zones, as being worse than war zones. And that is because we don't have enough staff, and the staffing is only going to get worse under current contract changes, because it is driving doctors away, it is driving medical students away, and it is driving A-level students away from applying. And that is not going to get better while the government wants 7 days worth of work for 5 days of money and 5 days of staffing. Ladies and gentlemen, would you get on an aeroplane where the pilot has been flying for 7 days straight without a co-pilot?
No.
This is an unappraised, unfair, and unsafe proposal from the government, and one that we as your junior doctors will continue to fight. The BMA have announced further industrial action. We have So it wouldn't be for me to comment on the benefit of a general strike, but let me leave you with one thought. A few weeks ago, Jeremy Hunt tweeted that he was proud that it was the third anniversary of the Mid-Staffordshire inquiry and report by Francis. That report stated that the reason the Mid-Staffordshire inquiry was needed and the atrocities occurred was because of unsafe staffing levels. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the spin and the hypocrisy we are facing from the government, who state on the one hand that the Mid-Staffordshire inquiry was a great thing and changes have been made, and yet they want to push junior doctors 7 days a week with 5 days worth of us so that you will be put at risk, The government will see an NHS that starts to fail. It will not have enough nurses because nurses won't want to study anymore because they will no longer get their bursaries. That will soon spread to midwifery bursaries, NHS junior doctor bursaries. It will spread throughout the NHS, as well as when they change all of the other contracts to 7 days as well. And at that point, the NHS will be crippled on its knees, and the Tories will be able to walk their friends and their colleagues into the privatisation of your public health service. We will continue to fight that for you, but we need your help as well. Please write to your councillors, your MPs. Be aware there is a NHS reinstatement bill coming up in Parliament. Feel free to join on Facebook and Twitter. We have the Forget Me Not campaign that has just started, which can be found under Don't Forget the NHS. Ladies and gentlemen, we need your help to save the NHS. Please don't forget us.
From someone who really knows what they're talking about and is involved. And all we've had up to now is just misleading spin. So please take the advice and do all the actions that have been suggested so that we can all support this incredibly important cause for all, that takes up all our lives. We're all reliant on the NHS. So those are the three speakers. Can I? Yes? I'd like to take any comments and questions to the panel, but first of all, there's someone there who...
Hello.
Oh.
Hi. I didn't really want to be here tonight, and there's a good reason. 4 weeks ago, I had an operation for cancer. If I hadn't have had it, sooner or later, there's a chance it would have killed me. Now, I was looking at the cost of that. I had it at UCH. And the treatment I had would be about £20,000. I had that on the NHS. Obviously, it didn't cost me a penny. Can anyone who's got 20 grand spare put their hand up? You know, so basically, any of you that were in my position, under the situation that the Conservatives would like, you'd have to find that out of your own pocket. And, you know, as I say, I really didn't want to be here. I'd rather be lying in bed, taking it easy, recovering. But it's important. Now, today on the train, I bumped into one of the Labour councillors who's more on the Blairite side. He told me an interesting thing. He said, Hendon Labour Party has now got more people than it's ever had. I think there's 800 members in the Hendon Labour Party. And I said, that's great. And he said, yeah, but the trouble is, there are all these momentum types. He said, none of these are prepared to do any work. He said, none of them are prepared to go out and deliver knock on doors or anything like that. Now, I think that's an absolute load of crap. I don't know if Paul's got a comment about that. But, I mean, basically, all I can say is, if you want to be in my position in a few years where you have to have an operation, and you want to be in the position where instead of having an NHS to spend the 20 grand mending you, or however much it may be, it comes out of your pocket and you have to get a bank loan because no one here said they've got 20 grand spent, then don't go out, don't knock on doors, and don't join this campaign. That's all I want to say, thank you.
Can you introduce yourself?
Because
you're a very famous blogger.
Sorry, I'm Roger Titchborne. I write the Barnet I blog in Barnet.
Thank you very much. Please, any contributions? Yes, the gentleman over there.
I just wondered whether...
Video?
How do I turn this on?
Double
mic.
No, it doesn't work.
Oh, there we are. Whether you are aware yourself of a...
Could you introduce yourself?
I'm Frank Provax, and this is my first meeting at Momentum. And that's not my voice fading to the microphone. So it's my first meeting, and I'm really encouraged to see so many people here, and that this seems to be great, gaining momentum, as one would hope. I saw a documentary several months ago on YouTube called Sell Off, and it's an incredibly enlightening piece of documentary work. And what it gives you is the more sinister context that the Conservatives are using to basically undermine and privatise. I recommend you watch it. The information we've received tonight has been really enlightening. But when you understand the sinister sort of operations that are going on bit by bit, salami slice by salami slice, there is another documentary about Lewisham Hospital closure, about how we no longer have a Secretary of State for Health, do we? Or is that being, sorry. But it gives you an indication of how cleverly this is being dismantled bit by bit under our feet. So it's the sell-off, and I'll try and get the other documentary. This is what we need, because we know that the press is generally not on our side, so we need to get this information out. That's what I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody.
While the microphone's being given, I'd just like to make an announcement. We've just had a message from John Mcdonnell. He is coming, but he's just going to be a bit later. He's just sort of held up, and he'll be here by 9 o'clock, he promised. So I'm sorry it's sort of a long evening, but it's worth waiting for, I know. Thank you. Can you introduce yourself?
No.
Hello?
Yep.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Austin Harney. I'm originally a former member of Chipping Barnet Labour Party member for years. I'm also the former secretary of Barnet Trade Union Council. We relaunched in 2008. Now, what happened was when I was in the Labour Party, when I was active in the Labour Party or in the constituency, and I even stood for Cease Barnet back in 2006 as well, I was very concerned about the trade union link. And what I had to do was to spend more time putting effort into Barnet Trades Council. Of course, myself, John Burgess, Vicky Morris, we were founding members of the Barnet Trades Council. We also believed it was important to engage with the residents, which was instrumental in getting Barnet Alliance of Public Services off the ground. And it's a great achievement. It's taken a while. We're now 2016, and I'm seeing a good tendency here in Barnet momentum, but this is just the beginning. We need more than just a talk shop. We need to go into the Labour Party wards, into the branches. We need to go knocking on the doors, but we need to go out and deliver the policies, our alternative to what this dreadful Tory council is doing, arrogant Tory council. It's going to smash public services into the ground, and by then, we will be able to rebuild them. So we have got a big fight, and it's not just talking, but we've got to start now, start the ball rolling, start to get more active. I do encourage people to join trade unions as well. I do encourage people to get active in momentum in the Labour Party. I think that's very, very important, how we can do that turnaround before it's too late. We've got 4 more years of another Tory government who is hell-bent on smashing the welfare state, and that, if that goes, that's going to be very, very difficult for all of us. So I do encourage everybody to be active. We need to keep fighting as well. I'm glad to hear John Mcdonnell is coming here tonight. I'm actually on the Labour Representation Committee, National Committee. We wanted to fight hard to make sure that, you know, we were accountable to the people as a whole, and particularly in Barnet and the local areas as well. We have to deliver a message that we have to get these Tories out. We do need a part. We don't want parties anymore that are committed to austerity. We want to rebuild this country, rebuild the public services that have produced the most vital, efficient delivery. Also, most importantly, I say the National Health Service, something that Britain was so proud of, and now the Tories are going to destroy it. And the marvellous work that the nurses, the doctors, all the people in the National Health Service do, they should be rewarded by us. We must continue to support them. So that's the message I just want to send. No doubt you may have heard it a few times before, but I'll keep repeating it again.
Thank you very much. If you're all happy, are you happy to sort of have questions and sort of little speeches like that?
Yeah.
No, I think it's really good. It's like, maybe I'll call then on Polly Napper, who's from the Save Barnet Libraries campaign. She's doing an amazing job, and she's getting a speech for you.
Hello, everyone. It's wonderful to see so many people here.
It's really exciting. First of all, I'd like to start by thanking Barnet Unison, particularly John Burgess and Helen, who've been absolutely magnificent in the fight to support our libraries. They've made it, you know, 10 times better. They make everything better and more effective. Very good. Okay, try again. So I'm going to start with some fun facts for you. Over a quarter of adults in Barnet have no qualifications. 19% of Barnet adults do not have the 5 basic digital skills, so that means they can't do the most basic stuff on the internet. 10% of Barnet adults have never been online, never ever. And yet, to qualify for benefits, job seekers are obliged to apply for jobs, and they have to do it online. And where are they going to do that if they don't have a computer? Their local library. And who will help them to figure out how to use a computer if they don't know how to do so already? Library staff. The current proposals for our library service will mean floor space will be reduced massively in most of our branches. I think most people don't realise that because there are so many other awful things, but we're going to lose a lot of books and we're going to lose a lot of space. And it's a stupid cut as well. We're going to the council are going to spend £6.5 million in order to achieve an annual budget saving of £2.4 million. So it's going to take 4 years before they see any benefit. So it doesn't even work on their terms. Unstaffed libraries are going to be introduced. I mean, this is such a mad idea. And this means that for most branches, there'll be no staff and in no responsible adult for between 60 and 70% of the opening hours. That means the building opened and shut by computer. That means the public resource where the only security is unmonitored CCTV. That means our libraries are no longer safe for unaccompanied children, vulnerable people, the elderly and the disabled. 4 libraries, East Barnet, Charles Hill, Mill Hill and South Frean, will be handed over to volunteers who are expected to provide 15 hours a week with an annual grant of £25,000. It's completely farcical. I mean, I think that what the community achieved in Frean and Barnet was amazing, and they are absolute superheroes, but I don't think they should have to do that. You know, all these residents will still be paying their taxes to keep chipping Barnet Library open for all those poor people in High Barnet. But in East Barnet and Charles Hill, they'll also have to volunteer their own time and their own energy if they're going to have a library service for their own communities. So that's not fair. Save Barnet Libraries has been campaigning since October 2014 to fend off these cuts, and we've started the process of judicial review, but the law is very weak for libraries. Judicial review will only delay the decision. It won't force Barnet Council to make a better decision. And the legislation that... The 1964 Libraries and Museums Act promises a comprehensive and efficient service, but the Act has no teeth. There's no proper definition of what a minimum acceptable service, and consequently, libraries across the country, and I'm sure you've seen it all in the papers again and again and again, libraries are being cut back brutally and repeatedly. And the bright idea in many councils is for volunteer libraries. I'm really disappointed John Mcdonnell isn't here yet, because I really wanted to lobby him. I want to know what the Labour Party policy is on volunteer libraries. Last year, during the general election campaign, Chris Bryan came to Golders Green Library, and he said that Labour were completely happy with the idea of volunteer libraries. And he wasn't interested in giving our library services better statutory protection. So if I'm not here, please can somebody ask John Mcdonnell those questions. Will Labour oppose the erosion of our library service and the wholesale adoption of the volunteer library model? Because I think that's appalling. I want the Labour Party to be sticking up for proper public services, for those libraries that our communities really need. And will Labour strengthen the legislation that protects our libraries so that the Act is there, the statutory protection is there, and a future right-wing government, and I'm sure there'll be more in the future, will have a harder time to cut back on that service? Because once they're gone, they're gone. And you know what? They're vanishing fast.
If anyone has any comments or questions for any of the things that have already happened, please let's have them. But again, this is an issue that is sort of all party, all age, all race and faith, and everybody is involved. And it's only... on the 23rd of March, I've just been told that there's a meeting at the Town Hall at which there will be a library lobby and you're encouraged to go. And there are two or three other announcements. There's this Stop Trident march and rally on the 27th of February, next Saturday. This Saturday, if you want to go to that. There's the Kill the Housing Bill on the 13th of March, national demonstration. There are leaflets here if you want to find out more about them. And there's also the Health Homes Job Education End Austerity Now, and that will be a national demonstration on Saturday the 16th of April. So there are those three events coming up. Someone wants to speak back there. Sorry.
Hey, sorry. Dan Ronsley, I'm another rabid Trotskyist and member of a group called Disability. I think that Momentum needs to campaign on three major issues. I'm going to speak to one of them because I think it's the most controversial, and I'll do my best to be quick. I think that Trident is a pressing issue. I'm not going to talk much about that because I think it's a no-brainer. We need to get rid of it. I think that we need to get behind the junior doctors. I'm sure everyone already is, and many people, that's already been spoken on fantastically. We also need to push for the Labour Party to back a national demonstration. I think that we need to get really serious about the campaign on Europe, and this I think is more controversial, and like the comrades spoke about already, we need a debate. Momentum needs to be a forum for these kind of discussions. So I'll throw my tokens in. We're going to see a carnival of reaction in the run-up to the referendum. And Momentum, I think, has to campaign for the UK to stay in. If the UK leaves the European Union, it will create more barriers for migrants, not less. It will further erode workers' rights in this country. And it will cut us off from the wider European labour movement. For those reasons, I think we need to campaign to stay in. But obviously, I think this has to be the start of a discussion and a wider debate. Thanks.
Phil.
Is it working? Yes. I might have to hold the thing properly. I'm Phil from the Barnet Alliance for Public Services, as is Theatre. We've been campaigning for the last 6 years against the privatisation of Barnet. And another thing we're campaigning about now is... another thing... I'll come down here. I'll take that with me. I'm a bit tired, actually, so... Okay, right. Now, TTIP, right? Who's heard of TTIP? Good. Before you fall asleep, who's heard of the ISDS mechanism? Not so many people. This is something very perfidious. This is a clause in TTIP where companies can sue governments. Now, what could happen? We've heard about the NHS and TTIP, but with local governments, if theoretically, if TTIP is signed, and Barnet sign a contract with a subsidiary of Capita, for example, in Canada, for example, then if Barnet wanted to get out of the contract and retake over the public services, Capita could sue the UK government, as they have sued Egypt for increasing the minimum wage. Although, that's just another example. Right, okay, now, what we could do, we've heard nothing about TTIP. I've been passing around a rather crappy board about getting Barnet to be a TTIP-free zone. We've heard nothing in the press about this. Everything has been smothered by Brexit. Ask the Daily Mail reader if they really believe what's in the paper. In 1938, they would have thought that Hitler was the greatest thing since sliced bread, for example. how our media. So we're up against our media. We've got to do something. It's like 1940 against fascism in Europe. Now we've got to do whatever we can to stop it.
Bill, can you just finish quickly?
Okay, two things. Please sign the petition I'll pass around. It's also on Google. If you go to Barnet TUC, if you don't like Barnet Green Party, you can find it there. Also, I'll pass it around later.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Right, okay.
Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Now we have someone that everybody knows in the room, I would think. Barbara Jacobson. And Barbara's speaking on behalf of the Barnet Alliance for Public Services, known as BAPS.
Yes, as many of you have heard, BAPS has been doing a lot in the community for the last 5 years or 6 years. It is a coalition of residents and workers. It is politically non-aligned, but it has been working for the last 5 years to fight the privatization of our public services. And I know this is where a lot of people have been talking tonight about what Momentum is going to do. You have to do more than just talk about it. Let me tell you what we've been doing for 5 years. For 5 years, we have been actively working. We have produced newspapers and leaflets, and we've distributed them on street corners and door to door. We have organized marches, public meetings like this, conferences, and rallies to inform people of what the council is doing and what the council is planning to do. We have collected petitions, signatures on petitions, and presented them at council committees and at council meetings. We have attended all those damn boring council committee meetings. We have read their badly written papers. We have asked them hundreds of questions that they refused to answer. We have made our statements to them and watched them as they read their phone messages instead of paying attention. We know what we're up against. The dumb and the dead sitting there voting when somebody pulls a chain. Now, if you want to make a difference, I'm sorry, but you have to go there and do that. Watch them. Call them out on it. Tell them to pay attention. At least embarrass and humiliate them to the extent that that is possible with the brain dead. That wasn't even in my script. We have supported films about Barnet. We have animations, three animations about different aspects of things in Barnet, including Save Barnet Libraries, on our website. We have sponsored and advised and supported other campaigns. We are currently actively supporting Phil with the TTIP campaign. We are active in supporting Save Barnet Libraries. We started by supporting Save Free and Barnet Library. And if anybody here has not signed the petition to prevent staffless libraries, it's down here in the front. Don't you dare leave this room without putting your name there. We fought the One Barnet privatization program. It was our biggest battle. We did everything we could, everything I've already mentioned to you. And we backed Maria Nash, who's sitting over there, who brought the JR against Barnet Council. And those of you who've been around and understand what happened know we lost on a technicality. Okay, we weren't astute enough to know we were being led up the garden path, and we were found out of time. But if we had been in time, the results of that JR were in our favor. So we had the moral victory and the legal loss. But we also had some very nice lawyers who did it pro bono. We have continued to campaign. We've been proved right, of course, about the disasters when we tried to show the councillors the risks involved in one Barnet and in their joint venture. But we have continued to campaign. We have supported the care workers in your choice, Barnet. We have supported the people in West Hendon and Sweets Way, and we helped initiate the Barnet Housing Action Group. We gave advice and support to the nascent group at Abbott's Way, who are fighting the relocation of the depot there. And we have always given our support to the Pinkham Way Alliance. There is not a single thing in this borough that has been for the people that we have not been supporting, including the NHS, every single time. Many of our activists, after 5 years, have retired. Others are just plain tired. But you seem to have the energy we need now. And that energy has to be to engage with these bastards. Sorry, with our counselors and with our politicians. To actually get them face to face. Do not settle for conferences and marches. You have to take it a step further. You have to talk to them, to their face. You have to make them look at you and even pretend to listen to you. Okay, because that is the only way we're going to succeed. There is a one-seat majority of Tories over the opposition in this borough. And unless we lock somebody in the loo or push them down the steps, we're going to lose all of the votes. Because these people do not vote with conscience, they do not read the papers, they do not think about the issues. You have to have a voice, a quiet, reasonable voice just like mine, and make them listen. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. Thank you for that, girl. Thank you. Thanks, Barbara. That was passionate.
Does that work? Yes. I'm Philip Clayton. I belong to Barnet Left Unity and I'm involved when I can find the time in a lot of different campaigns. Some of you know my face. I want to say a couple of things and tell you a quick story. First thing is... I don't know whether or not it's possible, but I'd like to see some kind of mass campaign in Barnet for withholding council tax. And just not pay at all, because we're not getting the services we're paying for. With no accountability, these private companies are allowed to say, sorry, it's commercially confidential, PFI, they're not subject to it at all. So I'd like to see if that can be done.
What's your story?
And I'd like to see a bit more direct civil disobedience, quite frankly.
Yes.
Blocking the roads. Anyway, just very quickly, I have a son, stepson. For various reasons I can't go into, he has to be in care. And he's just turned 21 a week ago. He was a NEET, not an education employer, was trained for a while. And he subsequently started a bricklaying course. He's now in his second year. At the last year sometime, he gets £56 a week to live on for everything. Last year sometime, he jumped a train for £2.60 fares. He had to get to college, he had no money. He stopped by an inspector, and he told the truth, gave his name and address and everything, and he received a notice from the court. I wrote a detailed letter to the court, putting out his circumstances, saying, you cannot fine this boy £100 fine for £2.60 fare. Right? Heard nothing back from the court. In the meantime, where my son was living, the council moved them out and moved them about 20 miles away. So they moved from Walthamstow over to Ilford. He should have gone to court. He didn't receive a summons. I don't know what happened to my letter. The next thing was he received a letter from a debt collector's saying he owed £769. He had a cheque given to him by the college to pay £200 towards transport costs to help him, and he sent that cheque to the debt collectors. And I thought perhaps, I told him he's stupid doing it, but I thought perhaps at least I'd leave him alone. He got a letter last week, which I've seen, came to my house. It's £56 a week, now going to be docked by £5 a week until £579 has been taken off him. Now, can somebody tell me how that is natural justice or any kind of justice? And, £2.60. And he's having £769 taken off him by a debt collection agency.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. Can I call on Ken Robbins, who's from the housing campaign? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Evening, everybody. My name is Ken Robbins. I'm a member of the Unite Union, the Housing Workers Branch, and a supporter of Defend Council Housing. And I was asked to come along just to say a very few words about the Housing and Planning Bill, which people may have heard about. It's currently in Parliament. Having worked and campaigned and written about housing for a quarter of a century, it's very hard to overstate the impact that this legislation will have on the future of housing in this country. We're going to see the sell-off of council housing and housing association homes. We're going to see less genuinely affordable homes for rent. We're going to see the ending of secured tenancies for council tenants. We're going to see the introduction for the first time of means testing into council and social housing. Potentially a ruinous cocktail for the future of non-market housing in the UK. There will be a fig leaf of protection for private renters. The increasing number of private renters who now have no alternative but to submit themselves to the super exploitation of slumlords. But private developers will be given free rein to make even more profit, and we'll see even more of the kind of disgraceful episodes that we've seen in this borough at Sweets Way and at West Barnet. So I want to urge everybody to get involved in a campaign that is growing and growing quickly at local level, at grassroots level, through trade unions, through tenants associations and other housing campaigns. We formed in December the Kill the Bill campaign. The Kill the Bill campaign is going to be here for the long haul. We are determined to beat this bill. There will be a national demonstration on the 13th of March. There are a lot of leaflets down here. I'd urge people to take them away with them. It is imperative that we beat this bill, but also that we look beyond this, because this is not just about one piece of legislation. It's about the future of housing in this country. And we need to rid ourselves of the tyranny of the market. And in the words of Jeremy Corbyn, there is no solution to the housing crisis that doesn't begin with council housing. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Really important. Just following that up then, may I call on Jeanette Evans, who is a local housing activist from our West.